AI is hyper-persuasive. What does that mean? It's innovative. What does that mean? That in an ideal world that helps us as humans thrive, what I worry about is organizations that aren't thinking about these issues.
You don't have to look far to find news about business leaders and employees exploring how generative AI can help us work better, work faster, work more efficiently. But real talk, are we actually getting more productive, or is this just the story we're telling ourselves? And what's up with all of the names? Co-pilots, assistants, agents, LAMs. It would be great to finally get an answer, simply speaking, to what's the difference between AI assistants and AI agents? And where should organizations and employees be directing their attention and resources to really accomplish efficiency? Well, today I'm joined by Ethan Mollick. Ethan is an associate professor at the famed Wharton School of Business, where he studies and teaches entrepreneurship, innovation, and AI. And he's the co-director of the Generative AI Lab at Wharton. He's also a popular author and blogger, and his latest book is Co-Intelligence, Living and Working with AI. Ethan, thank you so much for being here.
It's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
When it comes to Gen AI-based productivity tools, it kind of feels like there are too many terms out there, right? So let's start with, how do AI agents differ from, say, AI assistants, co-pilots, and large action models? Ethan, I need you to help us to get all of these names straight.
Well, it doesn't help that even the term AI is like in dispute, right? It meant something very different prior to 2023 than it does today. So you're not alone, right? The easiest way to think about this now is probably to think about what you've been using when you use ChatGPT is you're using a chatbot or an assistant, it's sometimes called. Then when you have a AI tool integrated into your software, like an AI help bot, or it's a tool that helps you, you know, finish your graphic design or something, that's usually called a co-pilot. And then agents are autonomous AI systems that will go off and do work on their own and set their own goals and just perform autonomous work. They're not there yet. That's what everyone's aiming for next. And large action models are a new made-up term for an AI that can actually do things. Like if you say, set up an appointment, it can actually act on your phone and set up the appointment for you.
Okay, so there are some real distinctions that you just drew in between each of those. So does the name really matter after all, if you're the one who's building it?
The one thing that I think we've learned about AI over the last couple of years is AI companies are terrible at naming things. I mean, who would have called ChatGPT 4.0 and Claude 3.5 Sonnet and, you know, like Llama 3.1405B? Like, these are things I have to say with a straight face now. So, like, I don't think we should worry too much about the names because they're a complete mess and it is confusing. I think that creates barriers that aren't necessarily there. Like, these systems are not that hard to use or to work with, and it just sounds harder than it is when we use all these names.
You've been doing a lot of research on the practical implications of generative AI, often hands-on. In a recent talk, you cited an experiment using Gen AI that resulted in a 40% increase in quality of work. Can you tell us a bit about that experiment? And then I also want to know what type of Gen AI was used for this, and what does quality mean?
It's a really good question. So the particular study you're talking about is one I did with my colleagues at MIT, Harvard, and the University of Warwick, where we went to Boston Consulting Group, and they gave us 8% of the global workforce. And we did an experiment. We developed 18 business tasks, ranged from like standard consulting tasks, analytics and marketing and persuasion, ideation. Some of the consultants got access to GPT-4, some of them did not. The people who got access to GPT-4 had a 40% improvement in quality, 26% faster, and got 12.5% more work done.
So when you talk about the amount of work that's being done, can you still break down how does that quality figure into it?
Sure. So we found this 40% quality increase that matches a bunch of other work that shows that when AI does work, it produces pretty high quality work out of the bat. I would say solid A minus from a lot of the most advanced models out there. Not always A plus, but solid work. And so we found that it increased the average quality, especially for low performers. So low performers got the biggest boost to their quality. High performers got less of a boost.
So this is an experiment. So now, how can real life companies achieve something similar? What key actions do they need to take in order to get here?
So that's where it gets really interesting. We are still seeing these kind of large scale improvements, but they're at the individual level. So individual coders who use these systems are much more productive. And by the way, everyone's already using them. Like penetration rates, from what we could tell from early studies, like there's a study in Denmark of all places from January of last year that shows that it was already 65% of marketers, 64% of coders, you know, 35% of lawyers were already using AI at work. The productivity benefits going to the individuals, though, not to the organizations. to have the benefits flow to the organizations, organizations need to think hard about how they're incentivizing people and how they're building organizational structures to succeed.
Ethan, how can businesses empower these productivity gains then, rather than having people hide them? Is reward systems the answer?
So it's a few things. Thinking about rewards is a big deal. Why are people incentivized to show you what they're doing? I've seen organizations give out $10,000 prizes once a week to whoever has automated their job the best. But even just doing things like having the company executives show you they're using AI can help make this different. And then there's the organizational structure piece. What do you do when you're more productive? What am I supposed to do with my time? That feels like a big question a lot of companies aren't asking.
So are there any other recent studies then that you want to name drop?
There's a lot of interesting work. We've got a repeated set of studies that show that AI is very creative. So my colleagues at Wharton run a famous innovation entrepreneurship class. They had the students in the class generate 200 ideas. They had the AI generate 200 ideas. They had outside judges judge the ideas by their willingness to pay, how much they'd pay for the product if it was created. Out of the top 40 ideas by willingness to pay, 35 came from the AI, only 5 from the humans. So we're already seeing higher creativity. Similarly, if you get into a debate with an AI, you're 81.7% more likely to change your view to the AI's view than if you get into a debate with an average human. So these systems are already extremely powerful.
I'm trying to figure out if I should feel encouraged and empowered by that research or if I should feel intimidated.
I think a little of both. I mean, I think it's empowering and powerful, but I also think we haven't started to really deal with the implications of all of this. Like, AI is hyper-persuasive. What does that mean? It's innovative. What does that mean? That in an ideal world, that helps us as humans thrive. What I worry about is organizations that aren't thinking about these issues.
Okay, so as long as the organizations are at least having this knowledge, that's a strong foundation for them to begin to think about it.
And thinking about actually changing things. Like, what are they going to do? Like, I mean, look, the number one thing that people tell me they use AI for secretly inside their company is writing all their performance reviews. Now, performance reviews are really annoying to write. They're meaningful when they're done by a human being. They're not meaningful when done by the AI. But it's the first thing people automate, right? Is like similarly, like actually I had a great experience. So I have to write letters of recommendation all the time for people. And the whole idea of a letter of recommendation is I'm purposely setting my time on fire as a signal fire that I care about someone, right? Like I'm going to spend 45 minutes writing a letter for you. I have to read all of your stuff and do your resume, then I write a letter for you. And the letter doesn't matter. It's the 45 minutes I set on fire that's an indicator that I care, right? Now, here's the problem. If I just put my the resume in, the job they're applying for and their letter, then I get a much better written letter in 30 seconds than it would take me to do in 45 minutes. Do I turn in the better letter that didn't take the time to write? Or do I turn in the worst written letter that took me 45 minutes to write? If you ask your students, they'll say, like, turn in the meaningless letter because it's better written and they'll get the job more likely. That starts to challenge how we view things. In fact, I had a student send me for the first time, when they asked for a letter of recommendation, they sent me a prompt. That they just said, paste this to the GPT-4 and use this to write the letter. No joke.
Did that student end up getting the job?
They did, yes.
Well done.
It was a good letter the AI wrote.
Well done. So based on where we are right now, do you think AI agents are the future of productivity?
So my book is about co-intelligence, the idea that people working with machines do better. I think that that is still very relevant. I think if you can figure out a way to work with an AI, you do better. Right? Agents are a different breed, right? Agents are the idea that I give an AI an assignment, write me this code to do this, do the market research, generate the report, come back to me. It's almost like we're with a contract worker. So all the AI companies think that agents are the future. We don't know yet whether they are or not.
Where do you sit on that?
Based on what I've seen from early agents, I think they're going to be a very big deal. I think assigning a tool to go out and do something in the world, I've already been using AI coding agents. I can't code in Python. I do a few hundred Python programs a week now because the AI does it for me. So I actually think agents are going to be a very big deal.
I mean, I'm going to put you on the spot here. Can you give me a specific year or maybe like a range of time that you think it will take for the future to be here?
I would guess 2024 if I had to guess. 2025 on the outside.
Okay, great. Along those lines too, I'm very curious about what will AI agents end up doing for us or with us that they aren't doing yet? Like, what are they lacking?
Right now, when you use an AI system, you have to direct it, right? It's designed to be a co-intelligence to work with you. I think that that is very different than an agent that just does the work for you. If I want to write a piece of code or write a document, I'm going to give the document to the AI. It'll give me feedback. I'll give it back information. I might have to paste in some research. I'm directing the AI. With an agent-based system, I would say something like, do all the market research you need to. Go out into the world and collect the data you need. Then write our initial draft. You know, simulate running a bunch of different people reading the draft, make changes and update it, give it to me when it's done. And, you know, also make sure it's on the website and well-formatted and figure out how that works and, you know, read up the latest research to make sure everything's up to date.
But is this something that an LAM can start to solve rather than an agent, to go back to our name conversation?
So LAM is a little bit vaguely defined still, but the way I understand LAMs are large language models that could take action. So the most common version is like on my phone, I can ask the large language model to do something. That is different from an agent because it doesn't require full autonomy, right? An agent has autonomous goals that it seeks to pursue as it wants to pursue them. While an LAM would be more like the example of like, you know, telling your coffee machine, make me the perfect cup of coffee kind of setup. And it would push all the buttons for you to set that up.
Well, it feels like Gen AI is something that people just need to dive in and start getting their hands dirty. What should companies be experimenting with right now to get productive?
The R&D process inside most companies is not for their product, but for their own process, has largely been outsourced to enterprise software companies. Like, you don't do the work yourself. You have IBM has been thinking hard about this problem and brings you a solution. And I think that the issue is that that's left a lot of companies without a lot of R&D bones, right? They're not used to thinking about how do I change my own process or approach. They build good products or, you know, services or solutions, but they're not thinking about how do I fundamentally change my organization. And I think that the real key is experimentation. What is AI good for? You're going to have to figure that out. And the people that figure it out are the subject matter experts inside your own company. The people who actually do the research today, who are using the job this all the time. So you need to empower everybody in your organization to be learning and testing in an ethical, legal way, but not so constrained that they don't get anything done.
What are Ethan Mollick's top five ways that Ethan Mollick stays productive?
So I differentiate in both the book and in our study between what we call a cyborg and a centaur model. So a centaur is like an AI model where you, like an AI approach where you like half person, half horse, you divide the work up to like, I like to do analysis. You do the emails. I divide it that way. Cyber work is more blended. You do the work with the AI back and forth, throwing off individual tasks. So for example, things I've done in the last day, we were developing a logo for a new internal project. So what we did was we sat down with Claude and said, here's the concepts we want to get across the logo. Draw an image for us of the logo. Try it against a blue background. What if this was more rounded? Can you think of a few other ways to do it? Another case was like, hey, I've got this document. I need it to be 50% shorter. Can you shorten it down without removing any of the important context? There was another case of like, you know, I read this academic paper and like, I think I get it. Can you just make sure this understanding is correct? Like, so lots of little use cases all the time.
Well, then is there a world where you OD on AI?
I mean, I think there's the same danger that we have of ODing on our phone. Like there is this kind of like, what is human? When is it inappropriate to do? We haven't just divided those lines yet. AI is a very profound technological change. We call these kind of changes general purpose technologies. They affect everything in our world. So the internet and the computers were one, right? It took a long time to play out. Electricity before that, steam. So they have lots of varied effects. Some are good and some are bad. And we're going to watch these things play out. So there's certainly going to be areas where using too much AI is going to be harmful. There's going to be areas where AI is going to be transformative in good ways. And we need to play this all out.
I want to do a lightning round. Are you down with that?
I'm always ready. Yep.
All right. So yes or no. What would you let an AI agent do for you today? Plan your next vacation, yes or no?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay. Be your manager.
Not yet.
Give you a health diagnosis.
As a second opinion, definitely.
But not as a first.
Well, I mean, I've got access to humans. My standard is always best available human. What's the human you have access to, and are they better or worse than the AI? AI is the cheapest second opinion in the world, and most of the studies show it's pretty great at medicine. I still wouldn't, you know, I'm not going to tell you on a podcast that like, to trust the AI rather than the doctor. Although I spoke to one of the most famous therapists alive today, a guy named Marty Seligman, who invented positive psychology, and he says that the AI is better than him at therapy. So, you know, you draw your own conclusions.
What about evaluate your performance?
I absolutely use it for that today.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you said no for that one, I was going to call you out. It's like, you use it yourself.
Yeah, all the time. Yep, of course. How is this? What would an outside person say about this? What would a high school student say about this? What would someone who's really critical say? All the time.
Can you complete this sentence for me? In 5 years, AI agents will
be ubiquitous in that you will see them anywhere you're online. You're more likely to run into an AI agent than a person.
What do you think is going to be the most unexpected place that we run into an AI agent?
That's a tough one. I mean, I like by the very nature be unexpected. I will tell you the unexpected place where I think there'll be the biggest delay. I think teaching is not going to change as much as people think. Classrooms and how we teach will change, but we're not going to replace teachers with AI agents, but we will supplement them with AI tutors and things like that. I think you're going to see AI agents in more high-end jobs than you think. I think a lot of first-run legal work might be done by AI agents, for example.
How did you use Gen AI recently on the job, and did it make you more productive?
As academics, we also review very high-end academic papers. I always review the paper myself, but afterwards I give it to the AI and say, what would you add to this that I missed? There was a flaw or issue to improve with the paper. It does a great job with that. That's very high-end PhD level work.
I like that. What would you add to this? Okay. Thank you. I'm going to use that prompt myself. Appreciate you. Also, does it matter if productivity increases if we're focused on the wrong things? Because how's Gen AI going to help us with that?
So first of all, it is a pretty good advisor and manager. So it might help us with that. But I agree. Like, part of the moment requires us to really think about work in a deeper way than we're used to thinking about work. We need to be thinking about, like, why are we doing the things that we're doing? What parts of the process can be improved, replaced, changed? Really big set of questions.
All of this builds up to an overwhelming idea that AI is going to be your coworker. What are the things that our listeners should go do right now to be better at work?
So I have four rules in the book, and I stand by them because, like, even though I wrote them like a year and a half ago, people have been telling me they work. So the most important is just use AI for everything. Like, bring it to everything you do. Everything you legally ethically can. You know, I don't know if you used it before this podcast, but I would have, if I was in your shoes, I would be like, give me some questions to ask. Then I'd be like, all right, let's role play back and forth some interactions with Ethan. Then I'd take this transcript and say, what were the most interesting nuggets where I might make cuts? How would I summarize this down? How can I turn this into a digestible format for different audiences? And then I might say afterwards, like, how do I email all the people on my team to let them know what was good about the podcast or not? You know, what questions should I redo or do differently next time? I would use it for absolutely everything. And that's how you learn what's good or bad, because it's not gonna be good at everything. It's gonna suck at some stuff. So you need to figure that out by using it. Second thing is just to realize that it's gonna do part of your job for you. That's not the end of the world. Jobs are bundles of tasks. We lose tasks all the time. Like, I'm a professor, by the way, out of the 1,016 most affected jobs by AI, according to most of the studies on this, business school professor's number 22. So I think about this a lot. And like, my job's gonna change, right? Like, will grading be done with AI? Will other stuff? But like, I'm still hopefully going to be talking to you here. So what I do day to day might change, but my core job doesn't change. So you want to think about doubling down on what you're best at, because whatever you're best at, you're almost certainly better than AI. Third thing, don't make prompting hard. Just talk to the AI like a person. Tell it what kind of person it is, and you're 90% of the way there. And then my last rule is, this is the worst AI you're ever going to use.
Ethan, you mentioned that one of the things that you do before you publish a paper is you ask, is there anything that I missed in here? So now I'm going to ask you, Ethan, is there anything that I missed, anything that you wanted to cover that we did not mention today?
I would say that I think these were really good questions. I think that the real issue is this gap between individual and organizational. And my biggest concern is that organizational leaders aren't getting it, right? So there's huge transformation happening under their feet. Organization is getting filled with secret cyborgs who are doing all their work with AI and not telling anyone. And if they don't realize that that is both a huge risk and a huge opportunity, and if they only treat it as a risk, they're going to lose.
This has been such a tremendous conversation. And again, I really appreciate you for joining us. For those of you who are watching and listening along, please let us know your thoughts in the comments below. And absolutely stay tuned to this feed, because we've got new episodes bi-weekly on Tuesdays. We'll see you soon.